Now let's talk about our first method for recovering depth based on focus or defocus, and that's called depth from focus. So here is a scene that is shown right here, and we can see that it's taken with a camera with a shallow depth of field. And we can see where the depth of field is. It's somewhere around here. And the idea behind defocus is essentially to take a series of images with different focus settings. For instance, by moving the image sensor. And so what you're really doing is you're sweeping the plane of focus through the scene itself, taking a stack of images, which is called the focal stack. And then for each point in the image or the patch around it, we're going to ask the question, in which image in the stack is this point best focused? If we can find that image, then we know what the plane of focus was corresponding to that particular image, and therefore we can estimate the depth of the point. The reason we know what the plane of focus is for each image is because we are controlling the camera system. So this is what we're doing here. You can see that we're changing the focus. You can, if you look at the image itself, you see the focus is changing as the plane of focus is swept through the scene. You might see some small magnification changes in the image, but ignore that for now, because whatever those changes are, we know what we are doing to the imaging system. Therefore, we can always correct for those changes and create a focal stack where everything is aligned. When you take a look at a pixel and you just look through the stack, you're looking at essentially variations corresponding to that pixel and its neighborhood. So our problem is pretty simple. We're going to take each pixel, a patch around it, and see when it comes into focus. So let's take a look at one particular patch, say this one right here. And what is being shown at the bottom here are essentially the sensor locations corresponding to these images. Remember that different points in the scene are going to come into focus and go out of focus at different points. And for this particular patch, you can see that this is when it is for sensor location 51.25 millimeters that this particular patch is best focused. And so if we had a method for figuring out when this scene patch is best focused, that is, if you're able to figure out that this is indeed the best focused patch among all of these, then we have S, the sensor location corresponding to that. We can then use the Gaussian lens law to estimate the position of the corresponding point in the scene, or the distance of the corresponding point in the scene from the lens of the camera. That's O. So O is S times F divided by S minus F. So in other words, our real goal here is to find S. It's to find the best focused image. Now let's take a look at an example here. Let's say that S is equal to 51.25, as in this case, and let's assume that the focal length was 50 millimeters. In this case, it turns out the Gaussian lens law tells us that the distance of the object is 2.05 meters. So the reason I show you this example is I want to highlight this point that by making very small changes behind the lens in terms of the position of the sensor, say for instance, you can actually realize significant changes of the position of the plane of focus in front of the lens in the scene. And therefore, with these tiny changes to the imaging system, you're able to recover the structure of a very large three-dimensional scene. All right, so now let's come back to our problem, which is how do we find the best focused image? So that requires us to appeal to image processing. So since defocus attenuates the high frequencies severely, it doesn't do much to the low frequencies. We said the defocus is a low-pass filter, so it is going to attenuate the high frequencies. We want to use some kind of processing of the high frequencies in the image to estimate the amount of defocus or focus that corresponds to that particular patch. So we want to measure the amount of high frequency content within each patch here. And so one way to do that is essentially say, what we're looking at is for each patch, how much change is taking place within the patch, intensity change. And we know that intensity changes can be measured using the derivatives of the image. In particular, we can use, say, for instance, the second derivative of the image. Let's say the image is f, the second derivative with respect to x, and the second derivative with respect to y would measure for you the amount of change that's happening and therefore correspond to high frequency variations within the patch. So we could use something like the Laplacian. The issue that we have with the Laplacian is perhaps the rapid changes in the x direction might end up canceling the rapid changes in the y direction. To fix that problem, we use the absolute values here. We're taking the absolute values and adding them up. And that's why we call this the modified Laplacian. So this is the del squared operator or the Laplacian operator, but we are modifying it by using the absolute values of the second derivative of the image in the x and y direction, very similar to the Laplacian. The Laplacian has also been used for this purpose. So we're going to look at that and use that as a measure of the amount of high frequency content there is within the image patch itself. So we can now create a focus measure, and that focus measure says, take a pixel, place a little window around that pixel of size 2k plus 1 times 2k plus 1, and for each pixel within this window, you're going to compute the modified Laplacian. Modified Laplacian can be computed with a window as small as 3 by 3, because that's what we used for the Laplacian operator. So you can take the modified Laplacian, and you simply add up the modified Laplacian values for all pixels within this window, and that is what we'll call the focus measure for that point x, y in the image. If there is a lot of high frequencies, you're going to get a high value for the focus measure. And if you have less changes in the patch, you're going to get lower values for the focus measure. So let's see how this works out. This is a stack of images, and let's consider one point right here. And we're going to plot the sensor location S on the horizontal axis and the focus measure value right here, Y. So if you take this point, you see that it sort of comes into focus around here, this particular sensor location. Indeed, you see that it produces the highest value for that sensor location. So we would declare that to be the depth of the point. You take that S value, plug it into our Gaussian lens law, you get the object distance corresponding to that patch right here. If you look at this patch right here, which is much closer, you see that it comes into focus here, and indeed you get a high focus measure value for S equal to 34, and you would use that value to compute its depth. So that's the approach that we use to compute depth for each point in the image using the stack of images taken under different focus settings. So let's see how well this works for an object, a simple geometry, a sphere in this particular case. And the sphere has a little bit of texture. It is this texture that allows us to recover depth from focus. So what I'm trying to say here is that here is a textured object. You have text here. So it has high frequencies within each patch. And that's what you need to actually recover depth from focus. If, on the other hand, you had a surface that looks like this, which has nothing printed on it, then for all the points inside the surface, as you change the focus setting, nothing is going to change. The only place where things are going to change is along the edge. Inside the surface right here, you get no variations, and depth from focus is not going to work. In other words, the focus measure is going to be the same through the entire stack for all the points inside. So one of the caveats here is that for depth from focus or for depth from defocus to work, you really need the surface to have texture. which is significant enough, that is enough high frequency information in each patch of the surface. So that's what you're seeing right here. There's a little bit of roughness to this ball, and that's the texture that is allowing us to recover depth. And this is the depth map that you end up getting. And as expected, you get these steps, very, very distinct steps. And that's because the number of depth values you can measure using this technique that I've described here is exactly equal to the number of images that you capture. In other words, the number of sensor locations, because all it's doing is saying, this is the sensor location for which this patch was best focused, and then you use that sensor location to compute depth. So you only get n depth values, where n corresponds to the sensor locations that we use. So the question is, can we do better than this? Well, the commonsensical way to do that is to just increase the number of images that you capture. Needless to say, that is, that's going to be onerous in certain applications. Let's say you are trying to recover depth in real time, 30 frames per second. You can't afford to take too many images in that case. So you can take many images corresponding to many different sensor locations, or you can use what's called interpolation. So that brings us to Gaussian interpolation. It doesn't matter what the texture is of the surface itself. It turns out that if you plot the focus measure as a function of sensor location, you're going to always get a function that looks something like this. It doesn't matter whether it's printed text or whether it's the rough ball, metallic ball that I just showed you, or whether it is grass or the rug. It's, of course, going to look different. The variation is going to be different. Perhaps it could be broader or could be narrower, but it's going to essentially look like this, meaning to say that it's going to have a maximum somewhere, and that maximum is where it is perfectly in focus. So one can argue by using a simple model that the shape of the focus measure function is always going to be Gaussian-like. It's a Gaussian whose parameters we don't entirely know, but it's going to be Gaussian-like, particularly close to the peak. But so if we can fit a Gaussian to the focus measure function, the discrete samples that we have measured, remember the samples we have measured are MSI, corresponding to the sensor locations SI. Those are the discrete samples we measured. If somehow we are able to fit a Gaussian to those samples, then the mean value of this, the Gaussian, which is S bar, would correspond to the sensor location, which if you had used, would have given you the absolute best focused image for that point in the scene. So that's what we're trying to estimate here. So how do we do that? Well, we use the Gaussian model. We say MS is equal to MP. MP is the peak, by the way, peak value. E to the power of minus half S minus S bar, which is your mean value, divided by sigma n. So remember, S bar is what we are interested in. MP is the peak value, and sigma M is the width of the Gaussian. MP and sigma n have to do, M have to do with the appearance of the patch itself, how much high frequency content there is, and what is the nature of that content. They're not of interest to us, but they're sort of things that we have to compute in order to find S bar right here. So the knowns are these discrete measurements MSI for each sensor location SI. So these are known to us. The unknowns are MP, S bar, and sigma n. So now the question is, how many focus measure samples do we need to fit a Gaussian? In other words, how many focus measure samples do we need to find S bar? So here's what we do. We first linearize the problem to solve for the unknowns. What do we mean by that? We have a Gaussian, and we essentially take the natural log of the equation, both sides. So you have log of ms equal to log of mp minus half s minus s bar divided by sigma m squared. Now we can see log of mp as a new unknown, and we know how to find log of ms. That's known to us for the measurements we've made. And so it turns out that this allows you to recover the unknowns using just three measurements. And so if you take the largest value that you've measured, let's say that that happens to be MS1 for this point, and the next two values, so the largest three values, MS2 and MS3, and we of course know the corresponding sensor locations, S1, S2, and S3, we get three equations right here. And these three equations can be used to solve for S bar, because they happen to be linear in the things that we are looking for. So you get a closed form expression for S bar. So once you have S bar, then that tells us where that particular patch would have been perfectly focused if you had taken an infinite number of images, and you plug that S bar back into the Gaussian lens law, and you get the distance or the depth of the point in the scene. So that's essentially the algorithm right there. You take a stack of images which correspond to different focus settings, which correspond to different positions of the plane of focus. And then we're going to apply the focus measure to the stack of images. So you get these discrete focus measure values for discrete sensor locations. For each point, you're going to pick the largest three values, and you're going to use those to then interpolate using the Gaussian function to find S bar, the mean value, and that then gives you hopefully a better depth value for that patch. So let's take a look at how well this works. So here is the same example we looked at before. This is your metallic ball, and this is what we had in the past, n discrete depth values corresponding to n sensor locations. And after applying this Gaussian interpolation, you do indeed get a very nice reconstruction of the object. Okay, so based on this idea, a system was developed for microscopy. So here is a microscope. The microscope has an objective lens. This is where the sample is placed. And here is an illustration of the same. You have the sample placed right here. There's the microscope, and that's your sensor location. And in this case, instead of moving the sensor location, what's being done is the sample itself, because it's very small, it's a microscopic sample, it's being moved through the plane of focus of the microscope. The plane of focus is right here. So you motorize the stage of the microscope to just move it up by perhaps a fraction of a millimeter or so. It's a very slight change. That's what this motor right here is doing. And that's going to produce your focal stack. And then that's used to compute the three-dimensional structure of the specimen itself. So here you see the video that's being captured, and you're seeing how the object is moved towards the lens. Let's take a look at that once again. So that's your focal stack right here while the object moves. And here are a couple of examples of things that were reconstructed using the system. So in this case, you have structures on a silicon wafer that are approximately 13 microns in height, very small structures that were reconstructed using depth from focus. And in this case, you're looking at the stomata or the air vent on a leaf, very small, again, about 30 microns in height. And once again, you get a fairly nice reconstruction. So this technique is now used for a variety of visual inspection tasks as well in factory automation.